Let me introduce the first speaker, María Angélica Fierro. She studied in Buenos Aires and also University of Durham, the UK, and now doing research in CONICET, Argentina, and writing many articles in English, Spanish, and teaching various places. And her paper is Platonic epoidê against evanescence, volatilization, animation of the soul, rationalism, simplification, and ontological stability in the Phaedo.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you for everybody to be here. I would like also to thank someone who couldn't come, but who sent me some very useful comments, which helped me to improve my final version of the third paper for today, which is with Christopher Rowe. And I hope that with your comments I will benefit with more criticisms to make it even better. So I review the paper and made some changes, and I advise you to follow the paper on the screen. One of the changes is in the title itself. It seems that the volatilization in English doesn't mean too much, or is not a very common word. So I also suggested evanescence or annihilation of the soul. Yes, the Platonic epoidê against the evanescence or annihilation of the soul, rationalization, simplification, and ontological stability in the Phaedo. In his preliminary defense, Socrates tries to emphatically convince his friends and colleagues who are by his side in his last moments, in distress but not without the feeling of pleasure, something that is rather unusual, atopos, from the point of view of common sense, that a philosopher would be cheerful in face of death because he has embraced philosophy as a way of life, and that implies the detachment of his soul from his body, and so his training for death when the soul is finally released from the body. Even though Cebes and Simias, Socrates' chief interlocutor throughout the dialogue, are inclined to believe Socrates, they cannot help voicing the fear that might afflict anyone, and particularly a Greek nurtured on Homeric beliefs from childhood, namely, that when the soul is separated from the body, there's no longer any place for it to be. On the very day a person dies, they fear, and just as it's becoming separated from the body, the soul is destroyed and perishes. As it emerges, it flies off in different directions, dispersed like breeze or smoke, and it no longer subsists anywhere at all. Phaedo 78a. As Cebes later asserts, it is somewhat childish to fear the annihilation of the soul. Though for this very reason, we might think such concern is visceral, irrational, and hard to eradicate. In any case, they expect Socrates to dispel it before facing his own death and leaving them forever, and to do that through his rather particular kind of epoidê, the spell cast by his magic words, that is to say, his philosophical speeches, which furthermore had been entirely consistent with the conduct of his life throughout his entire existence. Here I will attempt to show that Socrates' arguments in the Phaedo are mainly intended to prove two theses about the soul and its immortality in answer to Cebes and Simias' requests, namely, A, that the soul subsists after death, possessed the hypsichia podanantos to anthropu, and B, that the post-mortem soul possesses a certain power and intelligence, haikina dinamineken haifronesi. The twofold definition of the soul as principle of life and rationality is not a claim arbitrary, as somehow suggested by Robinson. Quite the contrary, the text establishes a strong connection between these two features of the human soul. First, this would be one, by providing reason for taking the soul as principle of life. Second, it would be two, by establishing the nature of the soul not only as something essentially simple and rational, but also as a potentiality, a dynamism in the Aristotelian sense, requiring moral, epistemological, and ontological development to achieve departure from the body and senses and gain contact with the intelligible to the largest extent possible. And third, that would be point three, last but not least, by suggesting a rich combination of one and two, that I just mentioned, such that the soul would attain greater ontological stability over and above a mere subsistence through this growing affinity with the forms. In short, with the expansion of its rational essence, the soul would participate more fully in the full reality of the forms, and especially in the form of life. By practicing philosophy, our soul would attain this ontological existential condition only partially while the soul is united to our mortal body, and more fully after death. The claim I made in this paper is that in the Phaedo, as indeed in other dialogues, Plato intends to show not only that the soul is in fact immortal, but that there are actually different kinds of immortality which mirrors our present existence. The protective character of the dialogue is based not only on revealing the advantages of pursuing philosophy as a way of life for a potentially better afterlife, but also, most importantly, for the condition of our souls here and now. The interpretation proposed here further assumes, without being oblivious to the criticism made about the logical consistency of the arguments, which we know there are many, that in his Phaedo, Plato does not intend strictly to prove anything, but is rather offering the best account possible of the soul and its immortality according to his own method of hypothesis. Many passages and authors, you can just look at them at the screen and don't read it to move quickly, yes, because we don't have much time. In the cyclical argument, the main goal is to use certain general principles to support the claim that the soul persists after death. According to the laws of alternation and compensation, on which the interlocutors and Socrates agree after a series of arguments, if life is followed by its opposite death, the reverse sequence from death to life should ensue. In this way, it is established that the soul must persist after this, as the principle of life of all human and other living beings, in a constant cycle of death and rebirth, or palingenesia, although, as you know, this word is not in the Phaedo. In the Phaedo, we only have palingenes type. Metempsychosis also is a later term, but the concept is the same. If we were to reject such conclusion, which is derived from the more general and broader principle that everything changes into its opposite in a cyclical and balanced way, we would have to accept a position that presents even greater difficulties for our understanding of reality, that the continuity of life in the universe may be disrupted. This first argument, which has been rightfully regarded as mechanistic by authors like Bloch, and is therefore liable to objection in the light of the teleological considerations later urged by Socrates as offering a better explanation of reality, is more convincingly corroborated towards the end of the purely argumentative part in the final argument, which is metaphysical in nature and guarantees, on the assumption of the existence of forms, the indestructibility of the souls based on the soul's essential participation in the form of life. Next, in the so-called argument from anamnesis, Plato attempts to establish a primary connection between the indestructibility of the soul and our ability to think, asserting that the soul must exist and possess intelligence prior to its union with the body insofar as it is born into the body with prior knowledge of the forms. However, during our embodied existence, this ability remains latent for the vast majority of people and is only developed in philosophers who strive to recollect lost knowledge. In this respect, it is to some extent true that we all somehow understand the equal, so we can understand and assert that, for example, two logs or two stones are equal. Therefore, we are equipped in a similar way to Kantian a priorism with some knowledge of the forms to bring order to what would otherwise be chaotic multiplicity. Nevertheless, it is the philosopher, through learning and properly remembering, the only one who can go beyond sensory perception insofar as he can understand and tell the difference between the equal itself and things that are equal because they partake of equality, but can sometimes be equal, sometimes unequal, and include other properties besides equality. Within the soul, wisdom in the full sense, phronesis, the knowledge of what is itself and by itself the forms, is thus potentiality, dynamis, that we human beings can develop to a greater or lesser extent. As we know, Simmons and Cebes' main objection to his last argument for the immortality of the soul, raised by Cebes, namely that only the pre-existence of the soul has been proved, with the argument from Anamnesis, is answered by Socrates, suggesting a combination of this conclusion with the one they reached before. However, Socrates himself notices that the combination of both arguments is not enough to cast away the fears of the child within them, as acknowledged by Cebes, half shocking, half seriously. Even if our soul existed before our birth and continues to exist after our death, and is, as the tradition has hardly largely held, evanescent, there is no guarantee that it would not finally vanish anyway. Because of these concerns, Plato then introduces the so-called argument from infinity, in which I intend to show Socrates, drawing on points from his defense, establishes a closer interconnection between the persistence of the soul, which has already been proved in the cyclical argument, and the soul's knowledge of the forms, which has been established in the argument for anamnesis, but showing how a soul's closer contact with intelligible reality gives greater ontological stability. That's my main claim here, really. As De Vogel, for example, has already pointed out, it is clear that this argument shows that the dualism of reality is present, in a way, in man too, the soul being more akin, syngenesteron, and more similar, homoioteron, to the intelligible, here mainly identified with the unseen, and in the passage I'm going to read, and the body being more akin, syngenesteron, and more similar, homoioteron, to the perceptible through the senses, here in the passage 79 AD, chiefly called the visible. Thus, Plato's description of human nature in the Phaedo, is analogous, prima facie, et mutantis mutandis, to Descartes' substantialist mind-body dualism, as passage 79 AD suggests. In that passage is where appears syngenesteron and homoioteron applied to the body and the soul. I'm not going to read it because it's quite long, and I don't have time. So I go to the next passage. Similarly, at passage 88, it is stated that follows. Would you say, Cebes, that the result of our whole discussion amounts to this? On the one hand, we have that which is divine, immortal, indestructible, of a single form, accessible to thought, ever constant, and abiding through itself. And the soul is very like it, homoioteron. On the other hand, we have that which is mortal, destructible, of many forms, inaccessible to thought, never constant, nor abiding through itself, and the body is very like that, homoioteron. I didn't mention that all the translations are Rose translations for the Penguins edition. However, the soul has an intermediate and at the same time intermediary status, as many authors have pointed out, including myself. Although Plato does not use these terms here, as he does in the case of Eros, said to be metaxy at Symposium 202b, 203a, and 204b. In other words, the soul possesses a chameleon-like nature, as posited by other authors like Bostock and Corneli in a recent article in Archive Journal. Insofar as it can either intensify its contact with the intelligible or otherwise undergo degradation because of its association with the perceptible by the senses through the body. Every man reaches either of the two status according to how he or she lives, although in our present existence the soul cannot achieve, even in the case of the philosopher, a complete release from its embodied condition. These two existential alternatives for every human being are summarized at passage 79c, which now I fully quote. Were we also saying a while ago that when the soul brings in the body for the purpose of looking into anything, whether it's through seeing or hearing or some other act of perceiving, because that's what looking into something, what the body is, looking into it by using our senses, then it's dragged by the body into things that never stay the same, and itself it starts wandering about in confusion, ditzy, as drunk, just because it's in contact with things like that. Yes, quite. But when the soul does its investigation alone and by itself, it takes itself off to what's unalloyed, eternal, deathless, and unchanging. And insofar as its aching singleness to that is always to be found in its company whenever it gets the opportunity to spend time on its own. It stops wandering about, and its relation to those other things, it stays exactly the same state because it's in contact with things that are themselves unchanging. And the name we give to the what the soul experiences in this case is wisdom, phronesis. Nevertheless, so what I claim first is that the soul has this intermediate state, which I have developed also in other papers. But this is the additional part which I would like to defend today here. Nevertheless, because the soul is not only most similar, homo iotater, but also more akin, connatural, syngenesteron to the intelligible, also okeion, peculiar, naturally belonging to the soul, whenever the soul becomes a slave to the body, focuses on bodily needs, and is guided by sensory impressions only. It drifts away from its authentic nature, and even retains something of the bodily after death, together with the desire for the corporeal that it harbors. As we learn from Socrates' elaborate description of life after death at 81 AD. Now, in order to develop such affinity with the intelligible, the soul must go through what can be described, I suggest, as a simplification and rationalization. Our embodied soul is only potentially uniform, composite, and then unchangeable and eternal like the forms. The partial achievement of such condition in our present existence, which actually would be, as already mentioned, about the development of the soul's real nature, requires a process in which the psyche strengthens its capacity of reasoning and its desire for the truth, while it weakens its bodily desires, so that it separates from the body as far as possible. Its separation from the body in life can then simultaneously be described, as some different authors have suggested, as a moral separation, insofar as it requires that the person should mind the soul and not the body, an epistemological separation, insofar as the soul should get away from sense perception and concentrate on reasoning, and an ontological separation, insofar as through A and B, moral and epistemological separation, consolidates its likeness to the forms and procures to itself a first class of immortality after death when real separation from the body takes place. It is thus through purification, catharsis of the soma, which is akin to all that is composite and corruptible, that simplicity and rationality are secured. Particularly singeness, which appear in 70E and its comparative form singenesteron and 79B in reference to the soul, suggests that the psyche actually shares the same genus as the form, and has then their same genealogy and kinship. So the use of these adjectives implies that the soul releases its essential nature insofar as it develops its affinity with the forms, which, owing to their eternal, uniform, and changeless essence, transfer to some extent such ontological qualities to the soul, as Hawthorne already pointed out. This naturally leads to Socrates' need to assert the existence of forms, which had been so far just taken for granted, insofar as they provide the best explanation possible of reality as a whole. Based as it is on this hypothesis of the existence of forms, the final argument also favors the interpretation I have tried to defend here about the immortality of the soul. This passage, as mentioned earlier, states that because the soul essentially partakes of the form of life, it is immortal. Now, to Plato, the uppermost level of existence is that of the gods, who, as a result of their constant contact with the forms, are paradigmatically immortal, good, and wise. As has been pointed out, it may thus be inferred that the greater the contact of the human soul with the intelligible is, the greater the soul's participation in the form of life will be, since, as described at Phaedo's 245c, the soul is a source of both constant motion and, as in the case of the gods of the myth of the winged chariot at Phaedo's, intelligent action as well. Thus, if the soul has embraced a philosophical existence, feeding its desire for wisdom as much as possible while it was joined to a body, then, upon death, when it becomes free from the mortal body, it may survive at a level of ontological stability similar, though not equal, to that of the gods. We find the same idea being put forward in the colorful symbology of the concluding geographical myth of the afterlife. I'm not going to develop that because I don't have time. I will go just to my conclusion. But this seems that philosophers have a better kind of existence and more stable kind of existence, similar to the gods and in contact with the forms, is in the myths as well. So to finish my paper, the conclusion, I propose then that Socrates hopes for a better destination after death, where he could finally attain what he had sought throughout his entire life, are based on the ontological soundness of his soul, nurtured by its contact with the utmost reality or ousia, the essence of things, to the greatest extent possible through the practice of philosophy. Thus, the soul's development of its similarity to the forms both guarantees us here and now best and most authentic way of life, and also makes us expect that in a hypothetical post-mortem existence, it will not be dispersed like breeze or smoke, but in fact achieve the fullest and steadiest form of existence after its departure from the mortal soma. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and we have 10 minutes of discussion. Yes, please use the microphone.
Thank you very much for your paper. I just wanted to ask you what you thought of Socrates as a parent presuppositionist. If we think we know anything about Socrates, it's that he loved clear definitions before he got down to things. And yet, to me at any rate, in the Phaedo he seems to operate without definitions. He has rather presuppositions. I mean, the big one is that there's a soul at all. What about all the people who come to the there even is a soul? Never mind its characteristics. But even if one concedes this, he seems to assume that, he seems to assume as a presupposition that that whereby I am alive is the same principle as that whereby I am a rational entity. But it seems to me that one needs to investigate this further. It is a presupposition. We may be dealing, at least theoretically, with two entities here. That whereby I am a living thing, and that whereby I am a rational entity. But the presupposition, it seems to me here, is that they're the same. My question is, do you think Socrates really investigates that? Another thing sort of tangential to that is the assumption that that whereby I am alive is itself alive. In other words, a living thing. So the soul is not just what makes me alive, it is itself alive. living thing, or that whereby I am a rational entity is itself a rational entity. But again, my instinct is to say, whoa, let's stop a bit and examine that. Look, the redness of a red apple is not itself red. The apples and so on. One has to keep these distinct. And so I'm sort of puzzled here that the Socrates who is so careful to get definitions as clear as he can seems to be operating with assumptions here rather than definitions in this dialogue. And I just wonder.
Actually, thank you. I didn't fully understand what you said, but I think I got the general idea.
Yeah.
I agree with you, and I said it in a paragraph very quickly, that for me here, he's employing his own method of hypothesis. And that means to give the best explanation possible. He's not trying, that's why I think he's not trying to prove, but to say, well, this is the best explanation I can give you about the immortality of the soul. And in each argument, he goes a bit farther. So he's not giving definitions, and he's operating with assumptions. Yes. Maybe the only thing that, well, and even the ideas, when he goes and says, well, when he puts the forms as the main hypothesis, that from which follows the rest, he's also operating with these methods of hypothesis, even if it is, if this hypothesis would be similar to the anhypotheton principle, because it would be the last principle from which we operate to explain anything, in this case, the immortality of the soul. Yes, I agree.
I have the same problem, it's easy to understand. Does it work? Yeah. It's easy to understand degrees in our lives. Okay. Everything is.
Is it easy to understand?
To admit degrees of immortality, degrees of intelligibility, degrees of rationality, degrees of attachment to the body. This attachment. You know, that's easy. But the question is, the soul in itself is immortal or mortal, or it's a question of degrees. As you present it, it seems to be a question of degrees. Degrees in our lives, that's it.
Yeah.
But I have the same problem as you have. I mean, can a soul be immortal and mortal at the same time? Because I like your analysis. I am grateful.
Yeah.
Because it's lovely, and I agree, and maybe he wants to say, if you go this way, you will be immortal, if you go that way, you won't. But that clashes with the problem Tom was raising. So.
Well, I think that, in a way, what he's saying is actually, that's what I, in a way, discovered studying the text more carefully, that in a way, every soul is immortal because every soul has this subsistence, which is proved already in the cyclical argument, and as it is proved in the Phaedros, that every soul is immortal because it's self-moving, it's a self-mover. But that kind of immortality does not guarantee the ontological stability that higher degree of immortality guarantees. I think that when everybody knows that when the dialogue finishes and before the meet, after all these arguments, he says, well, I hope things are like this. Was saying, well, I'm not sure if I have proved anything, no? Like, and so I come back again to what I said to Tom. This is the best possible explanation, that there are different degrees of immortality, and that one kind of immortality, the one that the philosopher gains, is safer than the others. Insofar as the soul associates with the body, we cannot be that sure that it cannot acquire its characteristics and somehow perishes, which is what they are afraid of. So they say, well, if you don't want to be afraid and be not feel fear of death, be a philosopher, be in contact with intelligent reality, and you have more guarantees that your soul will not vanish. Anyway, I think there is no absolute guarantee. It's the best explanation possible, and in such a situation that he is about to die. No? So,
the last short question.
Thank you very much for the questions, which were very useful.
Okay, we thank the speaker. Thank you. Our second speaker is David Ebrey. He studied in University of California, Los Angeles, and now he's doing research and teaching at the University of Wisconsin. His paper is entitled "The Cloak Make Objection and the Final Immortality Argument."
All right, just
can
people hear me? Yes? No? Maybe? It's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you so much. So I am going to jump in. So Socrates faces two objections to his affinity argument for immortality: Simmias's harmonia objection and Cebes's cloakmaker objection. I've just remembered what I wanted to say at the beginning, which is that my paper wasn't included in the first thing, but then when Gabrielli sent out the second one, it was, so if you didn't download the second version, you won't have the text in front of you, but it is in the second version that he emailed out. It was left out by accident of the first version. So if you pick his more recent email, you'll find it there, on page 242. Okay, Socrates faces two objections to his affinity argument: Simmias's harmonia objection and Cebes's cloakmaker objection. Socrates provides a very thorough response to Simmias's objection. What sort of response does he provide to Cebes's objection? After Socrates restates the objection, we're told that, and this is 95e to 96a, Socrates paused for quite some time, considered something by himself, and then said, "What you're seeking is no small matter, Cebes. We must study thoroughly and as a whole the cause of coming to be and ceasing to be. So, if you like, I'll recount my experiences concerning them. Then, if you see something useful in what I say, you'll use it to convince yourself about the points you have raised." This investigation leads into natural science, periphuseos historia, ultimately leading to Socrates' final immortality argument. So what's the relationship between Cebes' objection and the final immortality argument? Some commentators don't address this question. However, most say that the final argument responds to Cebes' objection simply by providing a new, independent argument that shows that the soul is completely immortal and imperishable. On these readings, there's no suggestion that he's responding to the details of Cebes' objection in any way. In this paper, I argue that the final immortality argument extends the affinity argument, filling in a gap that it left open. Of course, it's not wrong to think that the final argument is a new argument, but we can better understand the structure of the dialogue and the final argument itself if we see how it's connected to the affinity argument. In Socrates' response to Cebes' objection, which I just quoted, he says that Cebes will be able to use what he says to convince himself about the points that he has raised. It's not clear how receiving a new, unrelated argument for immortality would help convince Cebes about the points in his targeted objection to the affinity argument. Moreover, we expect a response to an objection to speak specifically to it, not simply to bypass it and provide a new argument. Occasionally, bypassing an argument bypassing an objection is appropriate, but it has the disadvantage that the objector typically doesn't learn what's wrong with his or her objection. At best, she's simply convinced that she must be wrong somehow or other. On the other hand, if I'm right and Socrates is addressing the specifics of Cebes' objection, this provides a more satisfying response, since he would not only provide stronger reasons to accept his conclusion, but also explain where Cebes' objection went wrong. On my reading, the final argument fills in the affinity argument by explaining in more detail one way in which the soul is akin to and more like the forms. By doing so, it shows why the soul is not like a cloak maker, something that is merely closer to immortality than a cloak. It's not that the soul is a defective or an incomplete form, closer to the forms and sensible things. Instead, the soul explains why the body is alive in a way that closely ties it to the form of life. In explaining this, it explains this because it's one of the bringers that always brings something, some opposite along with them. And as a side note, I'm going to call these bringers stay neutral on whether we should think of them as causes or not. So traditionally in the secondary literature, they've been called sophisticated causes, but some people have questioned whether we should think of them as causes. So the soul is also exactly like a form because due to the specific thing it explains, life, it doesn't admit death. Since it explains life, it's more like the forms than other bringers like fever, fire, and three. This is one reason why Socrates presents the soul in the affinity argument as having a special status, being most like the invisible things. On my reading, the affinity argument and the final immortality argument are one long investigation into the nature of the soul, an investigation made more precise by Cebes' objection. All right. Next section. So the affinity argument is an investigation into what sort, poion, the soul is. Socrates argues that it's more like and akin to the invisible things, and the only identified members of this class of invisible things are the forms, than the sensible things. And so since the forms always are and are immortal, the soul is too. Unlike the earlier immortality arguments, the affinity argument aims to explain the immortality of the soul in terms of its nature. The soul is the sort of thing that is most similar and akin to the forms, which are divine, immortal, intelligible, uniform, and incapable of being disintegrated, which always stay in the same state and condition as itself. Cebes' objection relies on an analogy, suggesting that the soul might have the features that Socrates describes and yet not be immortal, because it might be like a cloak maker and the body like a cloak. Just as a cloak maker is longer lived and superior to his cloak and yet eventually perishes, so Cebes suggests the soul could wear out many bodies over the course of a single life or over many lives, but eventually perish. In several ways, Cebes' objection is stronger than Simmias's. Both objections aim to provide something that's akin to and like the immortal things without being immortal. It's not clear that Simmias succeeds, since a harmonia is ruled by its elements, and of course it's destroyed when they are. What is ingenious about Cebes' objection is that the cloakmaker rules over the cloak, and in general is longer lived than them, and so genuinely shares in the features of the invisible things to a greater degree than the cloak does, and yet clearly is not immortal. So how is Socrates going to respond to Cebes' objection? He needs an account of the precise respect in which the soul is like the forms in order to show that it shares genuine immortality with them, rather than being merely closer to immortality than the body is. He can't show that the soul precisely is an invisible thing, since they are always the same as themselves, whereas the soul, at least sometimes, is not. In fact, it's only the rare soul with genuine wisdom that reaches a state where it's generally the same as itself. Thus, since the soul cannot be one of the invisible things, Socrates' strategy in responding to Cebes' objection is to show that it shares relevant features with them that make it imperfect. We can think of the groundwork for the final argument as coming in three stages. First, Socrates presents his method of hypothesis and hypothesizes that there are forms, which are the causes of things. Second, he argues that in addition to the forms which always are and are unchanging, there are the forms in us, which can flee or be destroyed when their opposite approaches. I will refer to the former group as the forms themselves, and the latter as the inherent forms. Third, Socrates argues that there's another sort of thing, other than the forms themselves and the inherent forms, which I call bringers, which bring along an opposite and don't admit the opposite of what they bring. With this groundwork in place, he argues that the soul is a bringer of life, that since it's a bringer of life, it can't admit death, and so is immortal. The final step is that anything immortal is imperishable, and so the soul is imperishable. Recall that the affinity argument is an investigation of what sort of thing, poion, the soul is. To my knowledge, commentators haven't noted that the final argument explicitly picks this topic back up. Socrates makes a point of determining what sort of thing threeness, fire, and snow are. The final argument tells us much more precisely what sort of things not merely near to and akin to the forms. It's the sort of thing to always bring an inherent form with it. Of course, merely knowing that it's broadly of this sort isn't sufficient, because things like snow and fire are bringers, but they're destructible. Socrates provides a more precise description by arguing that the soul is a bringer of life. This idea was entirely missing from the affinity argument. There, the soul is shown to be similar to the forms because it's invisible, and by nature such as to rule over the body. But those features seem incidental to the soul not being destroyed. By contrast, the final argument picks out precisely the relevant feature that is the basis for being immortal and indestructible. It explains what's unique about the soul that makes it most like the invisible things. Okay. So now I'm going to turn to discuss the bringers.
Come closer to the microphone so you can take it.
Yeah, sure.
Sorry.
So turning to my discussion of the bringers, let me start my discussion with a broad question. Do the bringers merely resemble the forms, or do they have a specific relationship to them that explains why they resemble? Compare how a picture might just happen to resemble a person versus how it can do so because it's a portrait of them. I'll argue that the bringers bring the forms, and this specific relation is why they resemble them. The bringers aren't merely form-like, they're form-like because of their relation to the forms. One of the key ways that the bringers resemble the forms is that they, like the inherent forms and like the forms themselves, don't admit an opposite. They either flee or are destroyed when the relevant opposite approaches. Another important way that the bringers resemble the forms is if they possess the feature that they provide the other thing with. I'll discuss this feature further in the next section. Throughout most of his discussion of bringers, Socrates simply says that they bring an opposite with them. However, he is occasionally clear that this opposite is a form that both characterizes the bringers and the thing that they bring the form to. And while he's not explicit about why the bringers don't accept the opposite of what they bring, surely this is because they are themselves characterized by this form. After all, he says that the bringers bring what they do by nature. They aren't accidentally connected to this inherent form. This is why, when the opposite approaches, not only the inherent form, but the bringer itself must flee or perish. There's a tricky issue that I'm not going to discuss here of exactly what the relationship is between the forms themselves and the inherent forms. You probably know that there's a bit of a literature on this. For our purposes, the important point is that the bringers have the characteristics that they do because of their connection to the forms. Okay, so the interpretation that I've set out so far provides a different reason to accept something that Denyer and Bailey have argued for recently, that we shouldn't think of the bringers as causes. This isn't essential to my view, but I think it fits nicely with the view that I've laid out. Both Denyer and Bailey note that Socrates never explicitly calls the bringers causes, and this, I think, is the strongest evidence for their position. They both claim that Socrates does not use the same sort of causal language for these bringers that he uses for the forms. And it's true that Socrates doesn't use some of the terminology for causation, such as poie. However, like almost all translators and commentators, it seems to me that we have the same sort of causal data at 105b and following. Thus, I think Sedley and Long are basically correct in translating, for example, and if asked what it is that, when it comes to be present in any body, makes the body ill, I will not say that it's illness, but that it's fever. So we have this causal data in a relative clause. Or we could say, it is by the presence of fever that in the body that it's ill. Okay, so we do have these causal datives, but I don't think that this means that the bringers need to be thought of as causes. Let me suggest instead that they're akin to causes, close to causes, but not strictly speaking causes. As Sedley has emphasized in Platonic Causes, Socrates, in looking for a cause of something, is looking for what's ultimately responsible for. Sedley connects this to the legal context of the Greek word aikia. Typically, what is ultimately responsible is not what is most proximate to the effect. Thus, in the legal context, we normally find the murderer responsible, not his weapon. My suggestion is that the bringers are not strictly speaking causes because they're not what's ultimately responsible. Instead, they bring what's ultimately responsible, namely the form. The bringers aren't exactly means, thus they're not like the murderer's weapon. They're more like someone who goaded on the murderer. The murderer is the primary one responsible, but this person did bring the murderer to the scene. The bringers bring the forms to the thing that are alive, or hot, or whatever it is. Note that this doesn't make the bringers merely that without which the cause cannot be a cause, those things discussed in 99a to b. It leads typically, such things are neutral between one result and its opposite. The bones and sinews are no more responsible for Socrates staying in prison than his leaving. By contrast, the fire brings heat and it never brings cold. And so it's closer to a cause than most of those things without which the cause cannot be a cause. This is why I claim that the bringers are similar to a cause, akin to a clause, but not strictly speaking one. The soul brings the form of life, but it's not a replacement for the form of life. This is why Socrates says that the final, at the end of the final argument, this is why he says that it rests on his earlier hypotheses. Keeping the forms as causes retains their crucial role in the explanation for life. Okay, so next section, soul as bringer of life. I think the key step in the final argument is Socrates' claim that the soul is a bringer. As noted earlier, it's a feature of all bringers that they are characterized by the opposite that they bring. Fire is hot, and it brings heat to whatever it's in. Threeness is odd, and it brings odd to whatever it's in. This actually relates to the question that Tom was asking in the previous session. Socrates explicitly identifies this feature of bringers at 104b to c. Notice that this means that the soul will itself be alive. Phaedo suggests, I think rightly, that in the final stage of the argument, Socrates relies on the idea that for a living thing to be destroyed, just is for it to receive death. So if a living thing can't receive death, it can't be destroyed. However, note that if this is right, then it's crucial that the soul not only brings life, but that it itself is alive. If the soul brought life without being alive, then it might be that the way in which it's unable to receive death is in the way in which a rock is unable to receive death. It's just not the right sort of thing. Note that Socrates simply gets Cebes to agree that it's by the presence of the soul that the body is alive. He never gets Cebes to explicitly agree that the soul is alive. So Socrates seems to be relying on the idea that the bringers have the feature themselves that they bring to something else. If Socrates doesn't rely on the idea that the soul is alive because it's bringing life, then he would need some other principle to establish the soul's indestructibility, other than the claim that when a living thing admits death, it's destroyed. It seems to me that the most plausible interpretation, and the most charitable one, is that Socrates is relying on this principle that he articulates, that all bringers have the characteristic that they bring. Is this a problematic principle, that the bringers have the feature that they bring? I'm not sure if it is or not. I sort of have gone both ways on this. However, it seems to me to fit very closely with the idea that the genuine causes are the forms, and that the other things are cause-like because they bring the forms. Due to Socrates' commitment to self-predication, the forms in us have the characteristics that they impart. The bringers bring one of these inherent forms, thereby bringing something that is F, and so makes things F. Given this model, and given that the bringers draw their characteristics from what they bring, it's natural that they too would be F, since they possess the inherent forms within them that they bring to something else. Okay, so in conclusion, we can now appreciate why Socrates says that responding to Cebes' objection would require a thorough discussion of causation. The giant build-up to the final immortality argument, from the beginning of the autobiographical section to the claim that the soul is a bringer, isn't just an excuse to discuss causation, the method of hypothesis, forms, and inherent forms. Instead, each of these steps plays a crucial role in the final argument. The last argument extends the affinity argument, showing more precisely the soul's relation to the forms, and why it is like the forms in such a way that it's immortal and indestructible. In fact, now we can appreciate that without understanding the forms, we'll never be able to fully understand the soul or why it's immortal. Now, this might lead you to think, okay, we can dispense with the affinity argument now that we've sort of seen the new and improved final immortality argument, but But I actually don't think that that's quite right. Socrates' view in the affinity argument is that the soul is naturally drawn to wisdom, and that it's an appropriate state for the soul to be in because it's akin to the forms, as was just being discussed. I don't see any way in which the soul, by being a bringer that brings life, would be akin to the forms in a way that would make wisdom its natural state. In general, the affinity argument provides the broad account of what sort of thing the soul is. This account helps Socrates explain, after the affinity argument, various claims that he made earlier in the dialogue, before the affinity argument. For example, that there's reincarnation, that the philosopher desires to be dead, that the body is a prison, and that we should avoid bodily pleasures and pains. The explanations for all of these claims rely on the soul's ontological flexibility. Since the soul can be more or less form-like, and since being a philosopher makes the soul more form-like, a philosopher can avoid these problems of the body. This flexibility is crucial for explaining many of Socrates' ethical claims. However, precisely this flexibility makes the affinity argument easier to object to in its narrow aim of establishing the soul's indestructibility. The final immortality argument provides a tighter argument for this precise conclusion by focusing in on one respect in which the soul is exactly like the forms.
Thank you.
David, at the beginning of the affinity argument, we have the claim that there are dual adetonantum, the invisible and the visible. And I have two questions. One is, how can something be more like the invisible or less like the invisible? It's either invisible or not, number one. Number two, what exactly is it about the soul that would lead you to believe that it is like the invisible? After all, if you say the soul is like the invisible is immortal, therefore the soul is immortal, you completely beg the question. That's a silly argument. What is it about the soul that makes you one should think that it is like the invisible, and how could you be more like the invisible?
Good. So I think that I think it's somewhat confusing, but it's the invisible things. And he gives a description of those invisible things, which are the answers to the what is it question. So it's not, so the term the invisible things, you're not automatically a member of this class if you are invisible. So the term the invisible things, I don't think is just the extension of anything which happens to be invisible. The invisible things are the answers to the what is it question, which are always the same as themselves, and which, so there's a broad set of criteria that you need to meet to be within this class of things, the invisible things. And then Socrates thinks that the soul is more like the invisible things. Well, it has one characteristic that they have. It's in fact invisible. That doesn't mean that...
That begs the question. That's the whole point. Why should you think it is?
Why should you think that the soul is invisible?
Right.
Oh, I see.
Why?
Well, one possibility is that Cebes could have objected to that, but he doesn't, right? So Cebes agrees to that it isn't seen.
Why should we agree with that?
Okay, so I think that that's a different question. So first of all, just to answer the question at first, so it's not seen according to Cebes. Cebes thinks it's not seen. And then you also have this idea that the invisible things are divine. They're such as to rule over the visible things. And so similarly, the soul by nature is such as to rule over the body. And that's another point of affinity between these two. Now, I think that Socrates in the affinity argument is telling us, in a sense, what he thinks the real nature of the soul is. Now, is there a way in which somebody else could have objected to this view? Of course. So I think you have to ask who's the interlocutor, what are the things that the interlocutor thinks, and there are various ways in which you could try to push on this argument. Cebes pushes in a particular way, which is what leads us to the final immortality argument. Somebody else could push in a different way, obviously Simmias pushes in one way, heavies in another. Somebody else could say, you know, I'm an atomist, I think it's a very fine set of particles.
Hi, David. So I agree with your larger claim that the affinity argument helps us understand the final argument. But there's this one small thing that I disagree with you on, and maybe you can say why you think this, or maybe you can agree with me. And that is, you said that forms do not admit their opposites, just like the forms in us do not admit our opposites. But actually, forms do not admit opposites because of the way forms are. Forms are auto cathotic. They are themselves by themselves. They're not relational. They're not comparing to other things. They are themselves by themselves. So they cannot have opposites. But the forms in us do have opposites because they are not auto cathotic. They are in us. They are relational.
Well, I think he's fairly.
I'm asking him.
So I think he's fairly clear that the forms in us are going to flee or perish if the opposite form comes. So I think that there is a form of largeness, that there are forms of opposites themselves, and there are forms in us. But the largeness, it's the largeness in me will flee or perish upon the approach of smallness. So that's what I mean by saying that they won't admit their opposite. The form in us won't admit its opposite.
But the forms themselves don't admit opposites, not because they will withdraw or flee or perish, but just because they are what they are by themselves.
So I think it's an interesting question whether the auto cathauto applies to the forms in us as well. After all, the soul is a bringer, and we can talk about the soul auto cathauto. So I don't know that that's something that applies just to the forms themselves and can't. And Socrates' language there is a little inconsistent. So at one point, he talks about the forms themselves and says that some of them are in things and some of them aren't. And so sometimes he uses the auto as a broader group, and sometimes as a narrower one. But so it's not clear to me. Well, so we would need to discuss more why it is that the forms in us flee or perish. And I think it's because of this basic similarity that they have with the forms themselves.
Okay, two more questions.
Thank you very much for your paper. I wonder whether you would agree with me that even on the most charitable interpretation, the great final argument proves at best, on the assumption there is a soul at all, there's a massive assumption, that on the assumption there is such a thing as a soul at all, throughout the time that a soul is a soul, it vivifies or gives life to that of which it is a soul. In other words, my problem is this, that RA in Greek obviously can refer either to immortality or invariability. Most of the argument is driven by the notion of invariability, what invariably happens, you know, when a bringer brings this or that. But it seems to me very difficult to move from invariability to immortality. These are two totally different concepts. And yet it seems to me the argument is driven by the one concept and concludes with the other. I'm interested to hear your views on that.
Good. So I guess I, rather than think that the assumption is that there is a soul, I'd be more inclined to think that the assumption is that there is life. So there's an assumption that there is life, and then there needs to be explanations for things, and the soul is the clear explanation for why there's life. So there is an assumption there. If you want to deny that there's any life, then yeah, maybe the argument's not going to get going. But if you have that, and then, I mean, I think that Socrates explicitly flags that there's a difference between the claim that the soul is immortal and that it's indestructible. And now the question is, what is it that bridges the connection between those two? And I'm inclined to agree with Dorotea Freida that that it's the assumption that for things which are alive, the only way for them to be, if they experience destruction, then they experience death. There's no other way to be destroyed other than death, right? So you don't say, oh, my friend, luckily, you know, he didn't die. He was just destroyed. Right? No, I mean, if he was destroyed, he died, you know? So the thought is, if there's life in something and it's destroyed, then there's death. And so then that's why I was saying near the end of the paper that the key thought is the idea that the bringers need to be characterized by what they bring. And then I try to give you his sort of broad characterization of what that is.
On the question whether the bringers are causes, I think the reason you were doubting whether they're causes, and maybe it's deliberate that Plato at least doesn't bring it, make it absolutely explicit. The reason you gave in favor of being good, the reason you, is this, am I audible? The reason why, the reason you gave, I think, is wrong.
Oh, okay.
Because the dative in 105bc is not a causal dative, it's a dative of interest. So that would need. So
okay.
It's just a matter of getting the rather complex grammar of the sentence, right?
Yeah, I've discussed it. Yeah, okay.
But there is another reason which you didn't mention, which is that when he talks about these sophisticated causes, such as fire being being what makes things hot, he says he calls this a new answer, an alternative answer to an answer that he previously gave. And that was the answer he gave at 100D. And that answer was explicitly the answer to a causal question, what causes things to be beautiful? And the safe answer he gave there was that it's the beautiful that causes things to be beautiful. He's now substituting a different and more sophisticated answer to that same question. So it seems to me that there's, that makes the case, at least, for the bringers being causes.
So which place were there two, because there's one place where it, the forms and the bringers are both answer the question by the presence of what, or however you want to translate that. So which place is it where they're both answers to the same question?
105b, he says he's answering to the previous question, the question that he answered previously, he's now giving a different answer, not the safe answer, but the more sophisticated answer, 105b. And that's the, as I have to repeat, that is a, replacing his old answer to a specifically causal question.
So, not using your translation, and don't give as your answer whatever I say in my question. But
sorry, I'm not talking about that bit. You're talking about 105C, are you?
Well, that was at 105B. You mean at the
105B to C. I'm just saying that the dative is not causal.
Right. And so then the forms and the bringers are both answers to the same question. And the question, and then what I'm asking is which question is.
The question is what is the cause of things being beautiful at 100D to E. The new question, the equivalent question, is what is the cause of things being hot? But they're exactly analogous to each other.
Okay, I guess I'm not seeing exactly, because I thought that the thing where he says, don't give us your answer, whatever I say in my question, but follow my example, whatever I say in my question, but follow my example. I say this because besides the safe answer I gave at first, I see another kind of safety, thanks to what we're saying now.
Right, it's that's this, the bit, yes.
Right, so, now, he's saying, don't answer these questions which are about to come, is how I was taking that. Whatever I say in my question. So now we have to wait and see what the question is.
I see, yes.
For if you were to ask me what it is that when coming to be present in anything's body makes that thing hot, I will not give the same ignorant answer, namely that it's hotness, but thanks to what we are now saying, a more ingenious one, that it's fire.
Right, so
that's the thing, that there are two possible answers to. same question.
Right. I won't give the same that I won't give that earlier answer to the question what causes because the earlier answer wasn't an answer to the causal question. So the strong implication is that answering the new question about what makes things hot is also a causal question. That was my argument.
I see. Whereas my thought was that, for example, somebody could say, by what was he killed? First answer would be by what or whom? By Frank, by Frank he was killed. No, not like that. So like in this case, it was a knife. And in that case, it was a gun. Now, by what was he killed? Poison. So that there's different ways in which you could answer a sort of by what question. And in the first set, you were looking for the proper cause. And now it's the same sort of question, but that doesn't mean that you're giving the exact same kind of thing as an answer.
Right, you're giving an improper cause, but still a cause.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. In addition, we are gradually moving from the epoidê argument to the final argument. And the last speaker is Satoshi Ogihara. He studied in Tokyo University and then got a PhD in University of Pennsylvania. And now teaching at Tokyo University Sendai in Japan.
Thank you, Noburu. In Phaedo, in Phaedo 95E92107A3, Socrates presents an argument by which to convince Cebes that the soul is imperishable, anoresson, or will never perish, which is the final argument. By 105E10, Socrates has had Cebes accept that the soul is immortal, athanaton, in the sense that is peculiar to this argument. According to the standard interpretation, saying so is to say that the soul will not both remain a soul and become dead. So as Socrates explains at 105E2-106D, if Cebes further accepts that what is immortal is imperishable, the argument will be complete. Then the argument will run as follows. A major premise, what is immortal is imperishable. Minor premise, the soul is immortal. Conclusion, hence the soul is imperishable. And Cebes does accept the major premise. He also gives a reason for acceptance, 106D24. Socrates concurs and gives a reason for concurring, D5-7, with which remark, Cebes agrees, D8-9. Then Socrates draws a conclusion and secures Cebes' assent, 106E12-107A3, so ends the argument. As this overview of the final argument shows, Cebes' acceptance of the major premise plays a crucial role. This in turn suggests that for the philosophical assessment of the final argument, it is important to understand Cebes' reason for accepting it as well as Socrates'. However, there seems something puzzling both about the contention itself of the major premise and about Cebes' reason for acceptance. In this paper, I wish to tackle these two puzzles. The contention of the major premise of the argument, which is to say that what is immortal is imperishable, looks puzzling because it looks false. It seems that, on the contrary, some immortal things can perish. Take an ice cube, which is Nicolas Dinger's example. According to the above implied account of the meaning of immortal, an ice cube will count as immortal, for it will not both remain an ice cube and become dead. But as a matter of fact, an ice cube can perish. Here we appear to have a counterexample to the contention that everything immortal is imperishable. Let us call this objection to the contention the ice cube objection. We can meet this objection by assuming that the word immortal is used in the following manner. That is, not anything counts as immortal if only it will not both remain what it is and become dead, but rather only what is currently alive can be immortal. Then an ice cube fails to constitute a counterexample to the contention that what is immortal is imperishable. For an ice cube which is not currently alive is hence not immortal. If I'm writing assuming that what is immortal is what is currently alive, which will not both remain what it is and become dead. Then what is mortal, Sneton 106.85, is, I think, what is currently alive, which can both remain what it is and become dead. The body of a living thing, that is the parenthesis, currently living and parenthesis body, is mortal. For it is currently alive, and can both remain a body and become dead. Well, the footnote number 8, trick is needed here. This example of a mortal thing is specified as a parenthesis currently living in parenthesis body. To make it pass the test of currently current aliveness, we have to appeal to the parenthesized modification currently alive. And to make that thing fit the description, can both remain what it is and become dead, we have to identify it as a near body and not as a currently living body. In what follows, I shall be assuming these senses of mortal and immortal on the ground that thereby we can defend the major premise of the argument from ice cube objection. Thus, we have a division of what is currently alive into the mortal and the immortal types. But it seems to me this system of dichotomy is not meant to accommodate everything that is currently alive. The exception that I have in mind is a soul-body compound. Well, when speaking of the soul-body compound, I have in mind creatures that are not gods. Well, I leave the issue aside as to whether for Socrates and Cebes there are gods that are compounded of soul and body. If there are, I should have said the exception that I have in mind is a non-divine soul-body compound instead. For the system of dichotomy does accommodate the divine soul-body compound, this is classified as immortal, since all gods are immortal for the speakers. But for the sake of simplicity, I shall be speaking as if no god had a body for them. But suppose that dichotomy is meant to accommodate the soul-body compound. Then the compound would be treated as immortal, for it is something alive, which will not both remain a soul-body compound and become dead. This is because for Socrates and his interlocutors, for a soul-body compound to die is for the body and the soul to get separate from each other, 64C. So the survival of the compound, qua compound on the one hand, and its being dead on the other are incompatible. However, Socrates and Cebes should not treat the soul-body compound as immortal. For if they did, then since they hold that what is immortal is imperishable, they would treat the soul-body compound as imperishable, but obviously they should not. So the dichotomy of mortal and immortal, if applied in the consideration of the soul-body compound, should not be applied to the compound itself, but rather to its components, that is, to the soul and to the body separately. In addition to the soul, Socrates and Cebes regard two more things as immortal. They are the god and the form itself of life, autototes zoes eidos. I take the form itself of life as the form in us, as opposed to the form in nature. For on my assumption that only what is currently alive can be immortal, the form itself of life is considered to be currently alive in the same sense in which the soul and God are. This suggests that the form itself of life enjoys an albeit everlasting temporal kind of existence, which forms in nature do not. In my interpretation then, the emphatic itself out of does not concern the contrast between the form itself and the form in us, but the contrast between the immanent form of life itself and something else that always brings it about, namely the soul. Two, the contention that what is immortal is imperishable, the major premise of the argument, becomes plausible under the assumption that nothing currently alive can perish except by dying. I take it that this is essentially Dorothea Frede and David Ebrey's idea. And this may well be at least one way of putting Socrates' reason for the contention. But what Cebes says in terms of his reason at 106D224 is puzzling. For there would hardly be anything else that would not accept destruction if that is immortal. Being eternal is to accept destruction. Sore gar anti allo phthram me dehoito e toge asanaton aidion on phthram dexikai. the participle phrase aideon on being eternal is, I think, explanatory. It means because what is immortal is eternal. So Cebes should be drawing the following inference. One, there would be hardly be anything else that would not accept destruction if what is eternal is to accept destruction. But two, what is immortal is eternal. Therefore, three, there would hardly be anything else that would not accept destruction if what is immortal is to accept destruction. Cebes' remark here at 106D24 is puzzling because it is difficult to make sense of his thinking that, two, what is immortal is eternal. One may find a dilemma here. On the one hand, the rule of argumentation requires him to be using the word immortal in the same sense as before, namely in the sense of will not both remain what it is and become dead. But if he is, he seems unjustified in thinking that what is immortal in this sense is eternal. For instance, something immortal may perish without going through the process of dying, just disappears, the possibility that we have seen excluded by certain interpretation. Or something immortal may become mortal and die. Suppose, on the other hand, that he is justified in thinking that what is immortal is eternal, but then the dilemma goes, he should be using the word asanoton in the sense of will not die, period. Then he would commit equivocation. I wish to save Cebes from such a charge. That is, I wish to show that he, while using the word immortal in the same sense, can be seen to have a case for thinking that what is immortal is eternal. To do so, I shall suggest that he might have a sort of theory in which it makes sense to think so. I shall have to be very speculative. Well, this is reason against my attempt to be sure, but imagine what would happen if no such attempt was made. Then Cebes would be speaking nonsense. He'd be either insincere or confused. In either case, it'd be shockingly uncharacteristic of the discussant who has proved so candid, clear-headed, and devoted to philosophy. So I'm still motivated to save him. Three, but before considering how Cebes might think that two, what is immortal is eternal, let us consider something that seems to me much easier, namely how he may think that one, there would be hardly anything else that would not accept destruction if what is eternal is to accept destruction. His idea seems to me to be that for anything existent, it ceases to exist if and only if it accepts destruction. Then the concepts of eternity on the one hand and of the non-acceptance of destruction on the other are close, to say the least. But the two concepts may be meant as distinct. That is, it may be that something's non-acceptance of destruction concerns that thing's resistance to a destructive effect that comes from outside, while the concept of eternity contains no special reference to relation to something outside. Well, this opens up the possibility that the contention that to what is immortal is eternal is concerned with immortal things' intrinsic power forever to exist. How might Cebes think too? Note first that his reason must be independent of any reason for directly, as it were, thinking that what is immortal is imperishable. An example of a reason for directly thinking so is the above mentioned reason that nothing currently alive can perish except by dying. For, if I'm right, two is a step in Cebes' short inference to three, three being that there would hardly be anything else that would not accept destruction if what is immortal is to accept destruction. For example, he is not inferring from the contention that what is immortal is imperishable to the contention that to what is immortal is eternal, but the other way around. Rather, I would like to suggest once more that his reason for thinking too may concern the immortal thing's intrinsic power forever to exist. More specifically, he may rely on something like a theory of what is currently alive, according to which the immortal type has a power to renew its existence forever, while the mortal type lacks it. for what might such a theory be like. Here is my inevitably very speculative attempt to construct one. One, anything is alive if and only if it is supplied with life. We have seen the idea of the soul supplying the body with life in the present final argument. Epeke no feru sadoen. One prime, anything that is currently alive stays alive if and only if it continues to be supplied with life. The idea of a continued, something like the idea of a continued act of enlivening was seen in Cebes' objection to Socrates. At 87D, 91, Cebes says, Two, anything currently alive is being supplied with life. Currently alive is being supplied with life either by itself or by something else. So provided that everything currently alive has each just one supply of life, then two prime, there are two types of what is alive. A, what is supplying itself with life, and B, what is receiving life from something else. And there's a similar contrast between what moves itself and what else this moves. In Phaedo's 245c to 246a. Actually, this is a key idea that I am using in speculatively constructing the present theory. Let us illustrate types A and B. In creature, the soul supplies life both to itself and to the body. So the soul belongs to type A and the body to type B. We had better not ask of the soul-body compound to which type it belongs, for it would be away from the original spirit of this dichotomy and complicate the matter fruitlessly. What about the immanent form of life? Here I read the form itself of life at 106d5-6 as meaning this. It can be thought to belong to type A, insofar as the immanent form of life can be thought to be supplying itself with life. This may be a novel idea, but I hope it's not absurd. We have better not say, though, that the immanent form of life supplies the soul with life. For then, the soul would belong to type B instead of A. Rather, the immanent form of life should be understood as contained in the soul in such a way that the immanent form of life supplying itself with life, and the soul's supplying herself with life are two descriptions of essentially the same phenomenon. The god too can be thought to belong to type A insofar as he can be thought to be supplying himself or herself with life. This illustration shows that we can understand the division of what is currently alive into types A and B as overlapping with the division of what is currently alive into the immortal and the mortal types. So let's understand for my purpose. Three, from A prime, anything that is currently alive dies if and only if it ceases to be supplied with life. Compare this conception of dying with the final argument conception of dying as accepting death that comes from outside. These two conceptions are compatible. Death that comes from outside can be understood within the framework of the present theory as what stops in whatever it occupies any ongoing life supply. 3.1, what belongs to type B on the one hand can die, for what has been supplying it with life can cease to do so. It ceases to do so when and only when it abandons what it has been enlivened. And there is no reason why it should never do so. 3.2, what belongs to type A on the other hand will not die, for it will not cease to supply itself with life. This is because it will not abandon itself. Of course, I have in mind Phaedo's 245c7a, although it's about the self-mover. Well, it is assumed, possibly problematically, that the only way in which an ongoing life supplying can stop is by virtue of the supplier's abandoning the recipient. This means that it is assumed that nothing of type A ever suffers from malfunctioning in life supply. This implies that no soul, as long as it remains a soul, will ever malfunction in enlivening the body. Well, this shows how much this assumption amounts to. Well, it is clear by now that the dichotomy of types A and B can be understood to overlap with dichotomy of the immortal and the mortal. So let's understand so. The above mentioned fact that the nothing of type A will cease to supply itself with life also means that nothing of type A will cease to exist. In other words, what belongs to type A is eternal. So what is immortal, which just is what belongs to type A from 4, is eternal from 5. This is how Cebes might think that, too, what is immortal is eternal. I do not mean to say that this theory is sound, nor do I claim that it is plausible for Cebes to come up with such a theory as he listened to Socrates' final argument. It does not seem utterly implausible, though, to suppose that the character Cebes, the fictional world of the Phaedo, might have had of a view that could be seen as a stimulus for conceiving such a theory. What I have in mind is the view of Agnion Cloto. As Aetius reports, quote, Agnion supposes the psyche to be a substance self-moved in eternal motion, fissing out of kineton kataidion kinesin, and for that reason immortal and similar to the divine things. And do not confuse, the term immortal in this quote does not correspond in the final argument in the Phaedo to immortal, but to imperishable. Anyway, the notion of a substance self-moved in eternal motion could be taken to point to the notion of a living thing of a type A in the theory that I have presented above. One suggests that Plato, quote, transcribes and adapts, end quote, Alcmaeon's argument when writing Phaedo's 245c to 246a. And it is from the Phaedo's passage that I have borrowed a key idea in speculatively reconstructing a theory that might be ascribed to Cebes. A possibility is then that Alcmaeon's type of view is behind both Cebes' remark at Phaedo 106d-24 and Socrates' argument for the immortality of the soul in the Phaedo's. Anyway, my main claim has been just that Cebes' apparently desperate remark at the crucial point in the final argument can be seen as grounded at all if we ascribe to him the kind of theory that I have sketched about.
This is on page 757 in the book, but see, you argue it can be thought of as belonging to type A, namely the soul, insofar as it can be thought to be supplying itself with life. We better not say that the immanent form of life itself supplies the soul with life, for then the soul would belong to type B instead of A. And I guess I'm a little worried about that. Why not think that the form of life is what really supplies the soul with life, that there's this other thing that's really what's supplying the soul with life? It's true that the soul always brings life, but why not think that the difference between the body and the soul is that the soul is always bringing life to things, and so it always is alive, whereas the body sometimes is and sometimes isn't. And in particular, I think I'm a little bit motivated by the thought at the end of the final immortality argument that this argument relies on his earlier hypotheses, which I take to include the hypothesis of forms. And there's a way of reading this where it looks like you can maybe dispense with the stuff about forms. If we can just say that the soul brings life on its own, it's not clear that we need the form of life also. After all, the soul is just sort of supplying its own life. Whereas if really all that it has, it gets from the forms, then they're the source. So why not put the soul into type B? That's the thought.
I have no good answer to that question, Dia. I'm trying to make sense of why Cebes said what he said. And you're right, Dia, my presentation doesn't give a full sense of the fact that this argument starts from the discussion of the forms. I admit that this is a weak point, but I'm focusing on what Cebes said. And even in my account, in the theory that I ascribe to Cebes, you're talking about the relationship between the immanent form of life and the soul. According to this account, they are two descriptions of the same phenomenon. So I have to think about it. But thank you very much.
Is it on?
Oh, yes.
Thank you very much. I'm on page 755 in the book. And I just wondered if you could clarify a bit what you thought was puzzling about Cebes's remark. You give two reasons. This is about a quarter of the way down. The first objection is that he hasn't taken account of what you call the ice cube objection. Is that right? I'm not using the word immortal in the same sense as before, namely in the sense of will not both remain what it is and become dead. But he seems unjustified in thinking that what is immortal in this sense is eternal. For instance, something immortal may perish without going through the process of dying, possibility that we've seen excluded. So I'm not sure why you think that's problematic, because the ice cube objection turned out to be one we can easily dismiss. It's irrelevant, as I understood you. Is this not the ice cube objection?
No. In my account, the ice cube objection has been dealt with by assuming that by restricting the scope of asanaton and athanaton. And so it's
right.
Already done.
So what's this objection?
What's puzzling about Cebes's remark?
When you say something immortal may perish without going through the process of dying, where's the emphasis there? On process, or is it?
I see.
When you say possibility that we've seen excluded, I thought that was a reference to your dismissal of the ice cube invention.
Okay, when I wrote this, I just had in mind the possibility that the soul just disappears.
Well, right, but that wouldn't be death?
Oh.
I think David mentioned this in his comments. It would be strange that you wouldn't read on somebody's tombstone, he didn't die, he just ceased to exist.
Right. He just disappeared without dying.
Okay, but so when you say we've seen it's lost the place now. We have seen this excluded.
Yes.
Where did we see that excluded?
Oh, well, it's Dorothea Fredes. It's the second page of my paper.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I can check that. The other point you make is, or something immortal may become mortal and die, but that seems to be some kind of error there. Because if something can become immortal, become mortal and die, then it was never immortal in the first place.
I accept that.
So yeah, I should.
Thank you very much.
It's time to close the session. So we thank the three speakers for the session and for this. Thank you very much.